does God want me to do in this situation? How many times we ask this question? We were not sure what is God's will. There are four things that we have to consider when we want to know what is God's will. One is the leading of the Holy Spirit. Where is the Holy Spirit leading me? The second one is the Word of God. What is the Bible telling me about this particular situation, if any? The third one is open and closed doors. Is God closing some doors or is He opening some doors? Because we might try to go to the closed doors when there is an open door and we don't want to go to that door. What is God saying? And the fourth thing, and we are going to spend all our time on the fourth one, is motives. When we ask God, what do you want me to do? What is our motive? Do we really want to hear Him tell us what is the best for us, or we want Him to do it our way? We can know our Bible backwards and forwards, but if our motives are not right, we will not be able to hear God's voice. How many of you believe that God really knows what is best for us? Okay. For the second question, please don't raise your hand. How many of you, although you believe that God knows what is best for you, you sometimes choose your own way? Don't raise your hands. The problem is, when we ask God to tell us what is His will, and then we actually expect Him to answer it our way. Sometimes God is going to say no to what we are asking. And sometimes we continue praying and praying and praying because we are not happy with the answer. When we don't know what God's will is, of course we're going to continue praying and praying. But once we know what His will is, there is no need to continue praying. This just tells us that we are not happy with His answer, with His will. We want to hear something different. And in this kind of mindset, when we have our motives, our desires, and we are not happy with what God is telling us, God can stand in front of us and we would not hear Him talking to us. Because we are not interested, we don't want to hear what He wants to say, we have our own ideas. And to illustrate this approach and problem, I think Numbers 22 is the best passage in the Bible. So Israel came to the plains of Moab. Their king Balak was worrying because the Israelites just wiped out the Amorites. And he said, I need a plan. Well, he didn't need a plan because God said to Israelites, you're not going to get their land. So he didn't need a plan. But either he didn't know or he didn't trust this information, so he said, I need a plan. So he heard about a prophet some 400 miles away, which is for that time very far away, and he wanted him to come and curse the Israelites. So he sent the messengers, and we read about this in the first six verses of Numbers 22. Last part of verse 6 says, for I know that those you bless are blessed, and those you curse are cursed. What a reputation. You know, 400 miles away. So this is not just some a local guy. It's well known guy that, you know, if he bless somebody, he's going to be blessed. If he curses somebody, he's going to be cursed. Verses 7 and 8. The elders of Moab and Midian left, taking with them the fee for divination. When they came to Balaam, they told him what Balak had said. "Spend the night here," Balaam said to them, "and I will bring you back the answer the Lord gives me." So the Moabite princes stayed with him. I want you to remember one thing. These people brought something with them. What was that?
Gifts.
Gifts. Payment. Money. Different things. Balaam did one thing that is very important. He said, "I'm going to talk. Wait here. Stay with me. I'm going to talk to God." So he can talk to God, and what is interesting, he uses name Yahweh. So he is talking to a true God. Ellen White says, Patriarch and Prophets 4:3-9, "Balaam was once a good man and a prophet of God, but he had apostatized and had given up to covetousness. Yet he still prophesied to be a servant of the Most High." Professed to be a servant of the Most High. So this is Balaam. And this is a good start. He tells them, "Stay with me. I am going to ask God what is His will." How many times we don't ask God for what is your will for us in a certain situation? We know what we want and we just go in that direction. You remember Joshua and his treaty with the Gibeonites. Did he ask God before when they came? No, he didn't ask. And he made a wrong decision. Verse 9. God came to Balaam and asked, "Who are these men with you?" When you read the Bible, other places, Balaam is called a sorcerer, not a prophet of God, because that's what he is. He was a prophet of God, but in this situation, when he is mentioned in the Bible, he wasn't. So my question is, why is God answering his prayer? I think there are two possibilities. One thing is God wants the Moabites to get the message. And because they want to hire Balaam, so he's going to use him. Second possibility is God always gives us a second and a third and another chance. So God wants Balaam to come back to him. This is why God is speaking to him. Verse 12, first part. God said to Balaam, "Do not go with them." Only if God was clear in his message to Balaam, Balaam would listen and obey. But the problem is, God was not clear. Excuse me. This was loud and clear. No question about what God meant. But like Jonah, Balaam did not get in trouble because he did not understand and he didn't know what God's will was. He got in trouble because he did not want to obey. And God did not just say, "Do not go with them." Second part of verse 12. "You must not put a curse on these people because they are blessed." Sometimes we know what God's will is, but we don't know the reason. But here we have God's will and the reason for it. It's very clear. Do not go with them. Do not try to curse the Israelites because they are blessed. So God has blessed the Israelites. It's very clear. Verse 13. So what we expect is something a little bit different than what we read. The next morning, Balaam got up and said to Balak, princesses, go back to your own country. For what is the reason? For the Lord has refused to let me go with you. Why he cannot go? This is not God's will, and I don't want to have anything with this. Is it what he is saying? No, he is saying, I would like to go, but God is not allowing me to go. Now, this is like a spoiled teenager. How many times we pray for something and we ask God for something? Job, car, house, spouse, whatever it is. And God says no. And we are not happy with that. So we continue praying and asking. Instead of saying, I'm not going to go with you, and you should give up trying to curse these people because they are blessed, Balaam is saying, oh, I would love to go, but God is not letting me go. How many times we behave like Balaam? God's will is very clear, but that's not what we want. And then we continue praying. What happened next? In verses 15 to 17, we read about the king, Balak, hearing not, I will not come and I will not do this. He hears, oh, I would like to come, but. And the but that he hears is, you need to pay a little bit more. I'm not happy with how much you want to pay me. This is not what Balaam said, but this is what Balak heard. And then he sent second group with more money, more gifts. When they came, what did Balaam do? I told you, I will not go with you. So go back. Not exactly. Verse 18. But Balaam answered them, even if Balak gave me his palace filled with silver and gold, I could not do anything great or small to go beyond the commandment of the Lord my God. Didn't I tell you? This is exactly what he said. Go back. I cannot do what you're asking me to do. But we didn't read next verse. Verse 19. Now stay here tonight, as the others did, and I will find out what else the Lord will tell me. He didn't need to pray again, because God was loud and clear, and God gave a reason why he should not go with them. How many times we pray to God and God says this or that, or he says no, but we continue praying because we want to get God to line up his will with our will. We have already made our mind. This is what we want. And when God says something different or he says no, we don't accept it. a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should change his mind. Who said this? Balaam said this. In next chapter, chapter 23. God is not a man that he should lie or change his mind. So he knew this. What is he doing? Why is he going to pray again? Although God was loud and clear. When God asks you to do something, he's asking for obedience, not interpretation, not another prayer so that he might change his mind. When God asks you to do something, be sure that somebody is going to come to you. The enemy is going to come to you and to try to trick you, to deceive you, so that you do not do what God asks you to do. The enemy, if he fails, will come back with a better deal, trying you to disobey God. The enemy will try you to believe, try to make you believe that you can at the same time have your wills and God's will. And we are talking when they are not the same thing, of course. If you compromise on God's will, don't complain for the outcome. In verse 19, Balaam said, I will find out what else the Lord will tell me. What else? Excuse me? What do you mean by what else? God was loud and clear. He gave the reason. What else do you need? How many times this is exactly what we do? God tells us what his will is, but you know, we continue praying and praying and praying because we don't like what he said. People say, I prayed about that. That's nice, but you know, Buddhists pray, Krishna pray, so it's nice that you pray, but what I'm really interested to hear about is, what did God tell you? What did God tell you? Balaam heard God. He knows what God's will is. But what was his problem? His problem were his motives. He didn't want what God said. He wanted something else. What did he want? I asked you to remember something in the beginning. Payment, money, gifts. In verse 7, we read about that. And second time when they came, they brought even more gifts and offered more, bigger payments. 2 Peter 2:15. 2 Peter chapter 2 verse
15.
They have left the straight way and wander of the follow the way of Balaam, son of Beor. And then it says, who love the wages of wickedness. Balaam did not want to do what God asked him to do. That's why he said, let me ask again. Maybe God will change his mind. What else God has to tell me? How many times it's clear in the Bible what God's will is, or God has answered our prayer, but we are not happy with the answer. So then we pray again, we ask again, we keep on coming back. hoping that God will change. And I quoted what Balaam said in chapter 23. God is not going to lie, he's not going to change his mind. Is this 100% correct? Verse 20. That night, God came to Balaam and said, "Since these men have come to summon you, go with them." Yes! This is what Balaam was waiting to hear.
This is a good answer.
There is one problem. Last part. But do only what I tell you. Not good answer, but better than the previous one. If I continue praying, I can get God to change the second part as well. So this is his attitude. His motives are money. He wanted to get something, so he could not hear God's will. And even when he hears it, he is not happy with that. And he doesn't agree with God that that's the best thing for him. How many times we do the same? Our motives stop us from hearing God's will, or we hear God's will, but we don't want to go that way. And then we continue praying and continue praying. Until God says, okay, you want to go through that door, you can go. It's not a good idea, it's a bad idea, but that's your decision. This is what God did with Balaam. You want to go, okay, but there is one condition. You cannot curse them because I have blessed them. But you can move. Sometimes God punishes us, in brackets, by giving us what we ask. And this is why Jesus has taught us to pray, "Your kingdom come, my will be done." Some are smiling, why are you smiling? I just quoted the Bible. I just misquoted the Bible. "Your kingdom come, your, not mine, your will be done." Well, this is not Balaam's attitude. Not your will, God, but mine. That's why he kept on praying and asked for the second time. Sometimes God is going to give us what we are asking for, although it's not the best thing for us. The Israelites were in the wilderness and they complained about the manna. You remember the story. And they asked for meat. And what did God say? Numbers chapter 11, verses 19 and 20. "You will not eat it for just one day or 2 days or 5, 10, or 20 days, but for a whole month." And listen to this. "Until it comes out of your nostrils and you lot it, because you have rejected the Lord who is among you and have wailed before him, saying, 'Why did we ever leave Egypt?'" What did God do? "You want to eat meat? Okay, I'm going to give it to you. It's not good for you. I gave you the best food, the manna, but you want this. And I'm not happy with your request." So just because God says okay, doesn't mean that is the best thing for us. Especially if in the first place he said no. Verse 21, we are going back to Numbers 22. Numbers 22, verse 21. Balaam got up in the morning. You can see the smile on his face. He can go. Yes, he cannot curse them, but you know, if he pray again, God will give him what he asked. Saddled his donkey and went with the princess of Moab. Finally, he can do what he wanted to do. Then verse 22. But God was very angry when he went. And the angel of the Lord stood in the road to oppose him. Balaam was riding on his donkey, and his two servants were with him. But God was very angry. If God says you first time, don't ever ask again. God was angry. Why would God be angry? He just told him that he can go. God has changed his mind, and Balaam is now doing what God told him to do. So problem is not with Balaam, problem is with God. Why did God change his mind? Is God deceitful? Why, when we don't understand what God is doing, we think it's his fault? Why do we doubt God's goodness while we are giving the benefit of the doubt to Balaam? Is it possible that problem is with Balaam? So that's why God is angry. That something has happened with Balaam. That's why God is angry. So shouldn't we ask, what is going on with Balaam? We can only guess. But Balaam is going with them, and probably he's thinking, how can I curse the Israelites? And God told him, do not try to curse them. So I can only guess what was happening with them. Because God would not be angry with Balaam if he was following his direction. Yes, God would not be happy that he asked them to stay and that he prayed. But he told me, okay, you can go, but this is what you cannot, you should not do. Do not curse them. God will never tells you no, one thing in the beginning and then later change his mind unless he explains, gives explanation. You remember the story of Abraham. God said to Abraham, Genesis chapter 22, go and sacrifice your only son, your lovely, beloved son. And when Abraham was there to sacrifice his son, what did God do? He said, stop! I don't want you to sacrifice your son. This was just a test. Now I know, of course God knew it from the beginning, that you are willing to do anything that I ask. And God has changed his mind, because all the way through, Abraham was praying and asking God, please, I don't want to sacrifice my son. And then when they were there, Abraham was praying and asking for God to change his mind. No. Abraham did not pray for that. He was, maybe while they were walking he was praying, but when they were there and nothing has happened, he said, okay, this is God's will. And he was willing to execute it. He was willing to sacrifice his son. With Balak, it's different. He is trying to twist God's arm. He is going to change God. How many times we know what God's will is, but we pray anyway. And we continue praying. hoping that God will change his mind. So, watch out if you keep whining to God about something that he told you no. Because at the end, you might get it. And you will regret it. You will have to deal with it. God knows our hearts. We can fool other people, but we cannot fool God. So what is in Balaam's heart? Greed for money. Greed for those gifts. And God could see the direction in which Balaam is going. And God is not happy because this direction is going to hurt him. But Balaam is blinded by his desire, by his motives. So he cannot hear God's voice and he doesn't want to obey it. God loves us so much that he is going to do what he did with Balaam, and we read this in 22. God put a roadblock on his road. God put a stop sign saying, dangerous, don't go there. Because God loves us, he is going to put roadblocks on our life. He is going to put a few stop signs. But if we have wrong motives, if our motive is to get something, no matter what God says, we will not be able to see the roadblocks, we will not be able to see stop signs that God put in front of us. So here comes Balaam, and God wants to have a little talk with him, but he doesn't have time. He's not ready, he doesn't want to talk to God. It's interesting, when we need God, oh, we want to talk, and we have time to talk with God. But when he wants to talk to us, we don't want to hear it, we don't want to listen. We have places to go, we have things to do. And now, Balaam is about to experience the transportation problem. And he doesn't handle it very well. Verse 23. When the donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand, she turned off the road into a field. Balaam beat her to get her back on the road. Now everything starts to go wrong. His good old reliable donkey, is giving him troubles. And he is mad. He wants to kill his donkey. He was so embarrassed in front of all these people. How many times God tries to get our attention by putting roadblocks in our life, and we just continue trying to go through the wall? But God is saying, no, this is not good for us. And he did tell us through his word, through the voice of the Holy Spirit, to open or close doors. But because we have wrong motives, we don't hear it, or we don't want to hear it. So 3 times, Balaam beats his donkey. And at the end, the 3rd time, God opens donkey's mouth and they have a conversation. And then, verse 31, first part, then the Lord opened Balaam's eyes. His motives had closed his eyes so that he could not see the roadblocks, the stop signs. Who feels like donkey now? When God opens your eye, you are faced with a decision. You are either obey God or you are going to continue your way. Second part. And he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with his sword drawn. So he bowed low and fell face down. When we recognize our mistakes, we can continue to fight through the roadblocks, or we can go on our knees and humble ourselves and say, God, I made a mistake. Verse 32. The angel of the Lord asked him, why have you beaten your donkey these 3 times? I have come here to oppose you, because your path is a reckless one before me. 4 different translations. Your path is reckless. Second, you are stubbornly resisting me. Third, your way was contrary to me. Fourth, thy way is perverse. They all say the same thing. Where you are going, what you are trying to go is not good. That's why I came to oppose you. Why is Balaam doing this? Because of the motives, wrong motives. Instead of wanting to obey God, his motive is go and get that money, those gifts. When we have wrong motives, you see what happens. We are going in a road of destruction and we are not going to see it and realize it. And even when there are stop signs and roadblocks, we are just going to continue because we have wrong motives. Not to obey God, but to get whatever we want. 33. The donkey saw me and turned away from me these 3 times. If she had not turned away, I would certainly have killed you by now, but I would have spared her. Balaam owed his faithful donkey an apology. If she didn't turn away, he would be dead. The donkey was trying to save his life. I don't know about this, but definitely her life. And by trying to save her life, she was saving his life. Perhaps there is somebody in your life that cared about you and told you what you are doing is not good. But you told that person, leave me alone, I don't want to hear anything like this. So when God turns you back, find this person and apologize for being rude. And thank that person for trying to save you from your destruction. 34. Balaam said to the angel of the Lord, I have sinned. Finally he got it. I did not realize you were standing in the road to oppose me. Now, if you are displeased, I will go back. What do I mean by if? If you are displeased. The donkey is talking to him. The angel has a sword in his hand. The angel loudly and clearly tells him, I'm not happy where you're going. And he says, if. You can see how motives can blind us, that we cannot hear and see God and his will. 35. The angel of the Lord said to Balaam, go with this man, but speak only what I tell you. So he went with them. 38. Now he is with the king. Well, I have come to you now, Balaam replied, but can I say just anything? I must speak only what God puts in my mouth. Did Balaam change his attitude? No. He has his goal and his motives, but this is not to do what is God's will. He wants to do what he wants to do. Repentance is not just a temporary short turn. Repentance is permanent 180% turn. Yes, on this road going back to God, we will sin and we will fall, but we are going in the right direction. This is repentance. Here we don't see repentance. So in chapter 23, Balaam asked Balak to build an altar and to sacrifice and to put an offering and sacrifice it. And then he said, oh, I'm going to seek the Lord and see what is he going to tell me. Excuse me? How many times are you going to ask God about something that he said no? And this is not once, few times, you know, they go from hill to hill. He's acting like a fool. God told him no, but he wants to get that money. So no matter what God says, he is trying to find a way to get it. Chapter 24, Numbers 24, verses 12 and 14. Balaam answered Balak, you know, after going from hill to hill and not cursing the Israelites, did I not tell the messengers you sent me? And we know what he said, I cannot say anything against God's will. Verse 14, now I'm going back to my people, but come, let me warn you of what these people will do to your people in the days to come. What will they do? God said to Israelites, this land is not yours. You're not going to take this land. So they're not going to do anything to them. But what is Balaam saying? Oh, I have advice to give to you. Oh, what was his advice? We don't know here. Chapter 24, verse 25. Then Balaam got up and returned home. Finally, he is following God's will. Finally. But when you read chapter 31, he's back. What is he doing back? Why is he back? Chapter 25. We read how Israelites were seduced into sexual immorality and idolatry. And this brought a curse upon them. And a plague has wiped out 24,000 among them. So, this, whose plan was this? Yes. But not just his. Who gave the advice what to do to the king, Balak? Who hatched this plan? Balaam himself. He could not curse the Israelites and get money for that. But then, you know,
another idea.
He had different idea. That's why God was angry with him. He was thinking, I cannot curse them, but how can I get money without cursing them? How can I bring curse on them without saying anything? Numbers 31. Numbers chapter 31, verse 9. So the Israelites fought against the Midianites. Verse 9. The Israelites captured the Midianite women and children and took all the Midianite herds, flocks, and goods plunder. And then 15 and 16, they came to Moses. Have you allowed all the women to live? He asked them. They were the one who followed Balaam's advice and were the means of turning the Israelites away from the Lord in what happened at the Peor, so that a plague struck the Lord's people. So whose plan was this? Ultimately Satan's, yes. Balaam's plan. So yes, God, you do not allow me to say words of curse. But you know, I know how to go around and to get what I want to get. And in verse 8, chapter 31, we read that Balaam was killed in this battle. So God didn't want Balaam to die. God wanted Balaam to come back to him. God did not want the Israelites to be cursed. God did not want Balaam to hatch a plan where, we read about that in chapter 25, where the Israelites are going to sin and then be cursed and 4,000 to die. God did not want that. So he put roadblocks on Balaam's traveling. That's why he said, do not go first time, do not go with them. But no, Balaam didn't want to hear what God's will is. And when he asked God what your will is, he didn't care about that unless it agrees with his will. What are our motives? When we ask something, when we pray for something, what are our motives? Why are we asking something? Why are we doing things? Money has blinded Balaam, and he wanted that money. He wanted those gifts, and he ended up being dead. It wasn't good for him. God knew it, but he did not care about God's will. So how many times we pray, and God says no, but we are not happy with the answer. So we continue praying and asking and asking and praying. God wants us to realize that the reason why sometimes we don't hear His voice is because of our motives. Our motives close our ears, close our eyes. We cannot hear, we cannot see God. We cannot hear what His will is. So let's pray to God and say, God, are there impure motives in my heart? Help me to have pure motives. Because with Balaam we see how it ended up. Not well for him. Not just that he's not going to be in heaven. His earthly life was made short. Because he had wrong motives. In Psalm 139, we don't have time to read, but read at home. David is praying and said, you know my heart, you know my motives. So please give me a pure heart. Help me to have pure motives. So when you pray, remember that God is talking to you through the Holy Spirit, through His Word, to open and close doors. But motives can make you blind. Motives can make you not being able to hear God's will. So let God help us that we can hear God's will and obey God's will. Because He knows what is best for us. And when once He says no, don't ask again. Amen.
Amen. Amen.